we discuss the variables. Tell me again the variables that we learned last time. Independent, moderator, control, extraneous, and intervene. Okay. The independent is the treatment, but independent is the outcome. The moderator, the variable, and the control variable, and sometimes they are quite similar, and it may be a little bit confusing for you at first to tell one from the other. But if you can use, you know, the name to identify. The moderator is the kind of variable that can be to see how different category of the treatment differ in the outcome. The control variable is the variable that you need to control in order to avoid the harmful effect of the extraneous effect. And the intervening variable are the variable that, you know, occur during the treatment and also somehow impact the outcome. So those are the variables. Next, what do you do? The measurement scales. Tell me some measurement scale that you remember. Nominal. Give me one example of a nominal scale.
Yeah.
For example, gender, nationality, sports number, ordinal scale. For example, student ranking, first to last. What else? Interval scale. Give me an example. Temperature. Degree Celsius. Degree Fahrenheit. Degree Kelvin. Lastly, ratio. What is the difference between interval and ratio? Yeah. Yeah. With the ratio scale, we cannot multiply, we cannot divide. And it does not make sense to do those kinds of comparison. We cannot say that, you remember the example that I gave you last time, you cannot say that cannot eat 10 times hotter than Paris. Because the degree of the temperature in Paris is 0 degree and cannot eat 10 degrees. So it does not make sense. Something? Okay, and then we move on to basic statistics. Mean, mode, median, standard deviations, and variations. Okay. What do you say variation in Vietnamese? You know what I mean? Yeah. And standard deviation? Good. That's enough. Now, there is one more time to show, and I just want to bring your attention to, and we will go back to this, you know, statistics, correlation of calculations later on. Now, in correlation of research, we want to discover the relationship between two or more variables. For example, I want to investigate the salary, the relationship between salary and the number of years that people work in a company. And my hypothesis is that the longer you work in a company, the higher pay you get. Right? That's a correlational study. I have to do correlational calculations. Now, the correlational research will help us to understand the conditions, the behaviors of the event. Take this as an example. Educational level of the farmer and the yields of their crops. The hypothesis is that the more educated, the more well-trained the farmers are, the better harvest they will get. But that's just the hypothesis. We need to prove it with the Pearson correlations. Another example is this one, high school grades and college grades. We will try to collect score for all of you when you first come into our university, and then 4 years later we compare all of your score, you know, your graduation score with your entrance score to see if there is a correlation. My hypothesis is that the bright student at the beginning to get a high score, they're going to get out. But it may not be true all the time. I have always seen people who did very well in high school but better in college. And also people who did quite badly in high school but really excels in college. I have a younger brother, and he is an athlete. He just, the opposite of myself. He is dark, tall, and when we were in high school, I did, very well in school, and he did terribly in classes. He almost failed to move up in his grade. But then, when he got the gold medal in the national competition for the spring wing, I don't really know that kind of sport. The Vietnamese is called Cầu Mây. So he got the gold medal. And he came to the University of Sports. When he got into that university for the entrance exam, he did terribly for biology or mathematics. He got only 1 for biology, 2 for mathematics, and 10 for the talents. When he got into the university, he did amazingly well. And he became a lecturer in that university now. So that's why you saw on YouTube, using a non-trip pool and all the muscle apps. It's because of my brothers. He practiced all those things on me. It's just after discussion to have you see that sometimes the correlation may not be as you expect. And the variables that we normally use in correlational analysis are continuous interval data. For example, your test score, your years of learning English, and your top 4 IB score, for example. your working in an organization and your pay. Now, the correlation of study will not work nominative or ordinative. Sometimes the ordinal data can be a interpolator. In the analysis, in the data analysis chapter, I think it will be in one single. We will learn the formula for calculating here. Since if you are interested in doing the calculation part now, you can see a link. System, I will show you how you can calculate all those stuff. But because it's too much calculation now, right? And you need less penalty when you combine zero with data analysis. Alright, just a few more slides, and I'll go to qualitative research. Now, for the research design, in quantitative, we normally have pre-experimental, truly experimental, and quasi experimental. Within the pre-experimental design, we can do one short study, one group pretend, one step. Study group comparisons. Why do we call it pre-experimental? It's not very strong. It's not as strong as the experimental design. So it's still not come to that level yet. And that's why we call it the pre-experimental. Okay, to a certain extent. It can be one short study. One shot, treatment. For example, I want to study use a PowerPoint, and there is the influence of PowerPoint on your writing final score, for example. So you have to one class. At the beginning, I give you a test. At the end of the course, I give you another test. During that course, I give you the treatment. I take using PowerPoint on the on one tool. And at the end of the course, if I see your score, improving, I will say, well, PowerPoint. To the method. That is called one shot study. It can be one group pre-test post test. Now, if it's one group pre-test post test, you also have you also have the experimental group. You have the text before you need the analysis, before you need the treatment. And then after the treatment, you give a text in order to measure the differences between the two tests. And all those two tests are about the same treatment. Now, obviously, these are not perfect designs. And they have some weakness, right? You cannot see the causes of the change between the pre-test and the post-test. A little bit stronger design for this is static group comparisons. We divide the subject into groups. However, you do not control the two groups. You do not make sure that those two groups are equivalent at the beginning. So, these are very simple studies, and they can be used as a kind of preliminary steps toward a truly experimental machine. Now, within the experimental research, we also have a leading design, and they also go up in the level of granular, of the level of power. In randomized group design, it's very similar to the static group comparisons, but we have randomization in order to ensure to prove and exactly the same before we conduct study. The pre-test, post-test, randomized group design is used when we randomize both groups at the beginning to make sure that we have completely equal group for the control and for the experimental classes. Then, for each group at the beginning, we did a test. It's called a pre-test. After the treatment is finished, we give both classes the post-test. We compare the the range of the control class, the range of the experimental class, to see whether the experimental class is significantly better than the control class. To make a conclusion, that's from the pre-test, post-test, randomized group design. The soluble form group design employs, instead of using only two groups, control group and experimental group, we need four groups. And the design goes through several stages. It's very complicated. So if you are interested in this time, you can go back to the textbook that I posted in the beginning system to see the procedure. But basically, this design involves more groups and more comparison analysis. The most important thing you need to keep in mind in pre-experimental is that there are no randomization, there are no comparisons to ensure validity and reliability of the research. And these are very easy to do. In experimental designs, you always randomize the subjects of the study. However, in the educational research context, you cannot randomize your students all the time. Actually, it's very hard. People will not allow you to do that because it will upset their training, their teaching schedule, and also their parents. They don't want their kids to be the subject of the research. It's not scary for them. Their kids are used. So, in educational setting, we normally use quasi experimental. Quasi experimental is similar to the experimental design, okay? But we do not randomize. Normally, we do not randomize the approach. Quasi experimental, it can be time series designs. We really compare the changes over time of one group. For example, I want to see the impact of PowerPoint on the learning. cell back in the first term, this term, and then the next term, I take you again. I will I do the same procedure, and I will try to compare the difference at the beginning of term 1, the end of term 1, the beginning of term 2, the end of term 2. Now, even in term 3, term 4, to see the differences. And that's it called time series design, a series of stages. You can also handle reversal design. In which you give the treatment, and then you take away the treatment to see whether if the result is the same, the outcome is the same, it is lower in the student's score. And then you give the treatment again, and then you withdraw the treatment. This is from the reversal design. This design is most popular. We call it a non-equivalent control group. Now, we try to find two classes. View one class as control, and the other class as the equivalent. And then we make sure that they are the same, simply by giving them a test. So it is very similar to the experimental design number 5. This one. But you do not randomize the participants in the two groups. So if you plan to do a research for graduations, you will see that most students choose two designs, non-equivalent control groups. They choose topic, for example, how to the use of pictures help students listening comprehension in high school. That's in Buddhism High School. So they go to Buddhism High School. They are given two classrooms and a practicum. Alright? At the beginning, they give two classrooms a listening test. And then they compare the test score, the mean score of the two classes. They say, you see, the two classes have similar the average score. They no big difference between them. So, they are the same before you do the experiment. Then, in class A, they take in a traditional way. In class B, they show the student a lot of pictures before they listen, why they listen. After 2 months, when they have finished their teaching practicum, they give the two classes one more listening test. And this time, they will compare the average test score of class A and class B. If the average score of class B is significantly higher than class A, they say, well, the use of pictures before and during listening really helps improve the students' listening comprehension. You got that? This is called non-equivalent control groups design. It's called non-equivalent because the subjects are not randomized. And in educational research, I have already told you, we have to do that in many cases because you cannot mix this class with the other class. The post-factor design is like the design number 3, but there is no control over the treatment of the groups. we normally imply a series of complicated statistics procedures to approve the outcome. Now, if you feel overwhelmed, we only design. I suggest to pay special attention to this one, okay, not the equivalent control group, because that's what you use most often. If you really want to ensure that your research has strong validity, then you can pay attention to number five is very often by students in the discipline of natural sciences like physics, biology, because they can better mind the subjects. So number five and number nine, variables, measurement scales, basic statistics, and the different design. Any questions before I stop here? We do want to quality research. Okay, so you are on a topic. I want to say it's from the ethnography concepts. Just to listen for 10 minutes.